If it had been a xylophone, it just wouldn't have worked.
Right, exactly. Or your beloved bagpipes there at the end.
Yes, that was the next one going to come out of my lips. Levi Stubbs tears. It wouldn't have worked. The atmosphere.
It's a Scottish funeral.
Hey everybody, and welcome to another episode of the Audio Files, the Friday Audio Files. Viewer request time. So we have got a spanking tune, which was suggested by Mike Summersmith and by Mark Hodgkinson. Once again, it's time for the Barda Barking, Mr. Billy Bragg. And the song that I both suggested is Levi Stubbs' Tears, which I know extremely well. So Andy is going to listen to it, and then we're both going to chip in with our thoughts on this ditty. Okay. So thanks both, and I think maybe some other people have maybe even mentioned this song as well. So
this won't be my first listen to Mr. Bragg, as we have reviewed him before on Into the Music, where you offered me up, I believe, A Lover Sings.
Yes.
Right? Okay, yeah. Yeah, a bit of a poet, as I recall. All right. This is an interesting title, right? So I'm already, like, kind of intrigued by the whole thing, but let me go off and give it a listen. I like the, obviously I love the bright tones of the guitar that are being used, and really the main, like, vessel for creating music in this number. We just heard the first change or divergence from that motif with some of that really interesting drum stuff that was peppered in there. It sounded like perhaps a mounted, like, tambourine on the, what I would assume is probably the hi-hat. So he's probably, because it's I don't know, maybe it was handheld, but it sounded more like your mountable tambourine hits. This is a story as much as, if not more than, just a song. At least that's the interpretation, or that's the impression I'm getting and how I'm interpreting it. Just, it seems to be really stripped back and focused on more so the story that Bragg is telling. That's where the importance seems to lie. But yeah, let's keep going and see where we end up with this.
I came out from the sea and put a hole in her body when our hole should be. Yeah, looking at the door, and all the sticks go back together. They left her heart in pieces on the floor. When the world falls apart, something's dying in place. She takes her off the full top's tight and puts it back in its case. When the world falls apart, something's dying in place. I stops to
Yeah, that sounded obviously very heavy. I mean, right when I hit on pause, it sounded like they were talking about a death scene, essentially. And the last, the end choice there of like the horn sound and the hand drums. I don't know. I suppose not the drums so much, but oftentimes horns are associated with, you know, they're often played in ceremony when there's a funeral or some sort of somber event commemorating the death of somebody. The name in and of itself, Tears, kind of put you in that headspace, right? Yeah, it was really pretty. It was a really pretty song, which, I mean, now this is the second Billy Bragg song that I've sat down and discussed on one of these reactions, the other being on Into the Music. And in both times, you get this, like, you understand that Billy Bragg is a poet at heart, I would think, who happens to have a command of music. Yeah, this seemed like heavy stuff, but it was pretty. It was. Sometimes awful things inspire beautiful ones. Let's get back to John and discuss it.
So here we are again. Mm-hmm. Andy, you've had a listen to the Teardrops of Mr. Stubbs, vocalized by Mr. Bragg. What are your thoughts?
Well, it's I enjoyed it. It was an interesting, it was a ponderous song because you know, as I was expecting that I would. And this is actually, he does a really good job of this idea of writing a song where the focal point is the story being told through the lyrics, because there aren't a lot of bells and whistles or distractions in the way of music. And I think that was, you know, definitely employed here, given that he wanted us to probably hear the story, even over the really pretty guitar that I assume that's him playing along. Yes. With it. Yeah, it's the starts with this beautiful, bright and crisp kind of reverb injected guitar that really is 90% of the music in this song, probably. You know, I didn't run the maths or anything, but that just, it clearly the featured player from a musical standpoint, that and his voice, right? And you can tell this is a narrative or a tale, just as much, if not more, than it is a song, for a lot of its duration. And it's funny, it is like it was extra interesting. And I think I've said this before, and it was probably about Bragg, but I can't remember exactly. But like, there are certain, your country is so rich in accents, and I adore, it's one of my favorite qualities about it, because it proves what time and like being, you know, sort of sequestered in your areas, isolated, will do for an accent, and let it build and become robust like a wine. But there's something about the, what I assume is like the Cockney accent, when is it not Cockney? What accent is this?
We've got different names for it, but basically he's from Essex, so it's an Essex accent. So it's
Okay.
north of London.
Yes. But there is this,
It's not dissimilar, but you would get absolutely mugged in Essex if you called them all colonies.
yeah, and I don't want to experience that. But there is, because I'm headed there next Tuesday. There is a really, really
Don't
like
show me why it's here. Sorry.
there this funny thing that they do with like the long A sound that ends up sounding like a long I sound. So there's almost this translating I have to do when I'm listening to these lyrics that I know are pivotal, but there's this extra bit of work involved with it. But
I
it was
did
so,
wonder. I did wonder how much you would struggle with his voice or not, you know.
yeah. And it's not an indictment on him. I mean, come on, you're gonna have this when people are from different parts of the world and speak a different version of the same language. But
No.
it made it all that much more fun, to be honest with you, is kind of like this little decoding effort for me. But
No, I love it. I love it when people sing in their natural accent. I mean, it's
yes.
just, we had a talk about this recently, about there was a while when all Scottish bands sung in a mid-Atlantic accent, and it was just ridiculous.
Yeah.
And then you had in the early to mid-80s, the Proclaimers came along, who could not be more Scottish if you tried, and
Yes.
they're just singing, and it was amazing and just wonderful to hear. And so I do love it. And it's the same with, you know, American bands singing in their accent. It's great. I love it. It
Yeah.
makes it harder, but you know, once you get it, it makes it more satisfying.
And it makes him very genuine, right? So like
Yeah,
he's
yeah.
totally being who he is. This is Billy Bragg delivering a Billy Bragg song. So it was fun for me. But yeah, it sounds like the song begins with like the protagonist settling into a mobile home and a new life alone. And there's some allusion to being like feeling like up against the world, like completely lonely, the worst kind of lonely, when you're not only lonely, but you feel like everyone's out to get you, or the world's out to get you. And the chorus then comes in, and I find the chorus to be the most interesting part of the song. Perhaps the I find it more, like I said earlier, like ponderous at first, but then by the time I hear it at the end, I understand it more, and it makes it more beautiful to me, at that point. But like, when the world falls apart, some things stay in place. Levi Stubbs' tears run down his face. It's an interesting allusion to the, like, was that the is it the Four Tops, the Motown? I knew he was a Motown guy. I'm not completely ignorant to Motown, but it's not one of those where I'm like super learned in it. But that some names stick out, and thank God for the most part he stuck to ones I knew as the song went on, or else I probably would have been up Schitt's Creek, like, who are these people? But nonetheless, it's like an interesting allusion to an American like singer, Motown singer songwriter. But it like, I'm at this point, I'm curious what this means and why it's relevant to the narrative being told to this point, because there's no connection. And the following verse appears to be more like reflective and like talking about how the protagonist ran away from home and was pregnant before she was old enough to vote, I think is one of the, he sort of conveys that there. And so this to me screams retrospective. Like, we start off with where she is, and now we're looking back to how she got there, sort of situation. And there's this reference to this husband figure who seems like a real treat. This guy that he laughs at his own jokes, is an attribute that's listed, and he's the kind that would leave her basically without notice or explanation. I don't know if what he was trying to convey is he's the kind of guy that would sign up for war just to get away from her, and he's the kind that would leave even if there wasn't a war going on. But there's something to that effect being conveyed in the lyrics, and I thought that that was an interesting bit of character building with this husband figure. So more references to Motown legends, which is helping me. And this is Whitfield and Strong, like the songwriter production team or whatever. And then Holland Dozier Holland, which I don't know anything about other than I think two of them are brothers. And there was like a they were like a triad of producers or writers or something like that for Motown. I don't know much about them. But they're
you will do by the end of this episode. Don't
okay,
worry.
Yeah. So but this time it's directly saying that they are comforting her. And naturally you think, this isn't a literal comfort. They're comforting her through their music. She's dealing with her pain through listening to music. And now that helps me understand the Stubbs illusion from earlier, which is like, oh, and maybe the one she listens to most happens to be Levi Stubbs, or for whatever reason, Bragg chose him to be the title feature in this one. But he then talks about how the husband came home from overseas and abused and like perhaps even stabbed or shot the protagonist, or perhaps that's too literal. And the hole that he's talking about is more like the one in her heart he left when he came home and was like, hey, I, you know, knocked up a, you know, lady of the night overseas and we've got two kids, just, you know, whatever story he dropped on her when he came back, like I'm out of here or whatever. And he leaves her, and the last chorus helped put things into perspective and perhaps were the most bittersweet of all the tragic lyrics throughout this tune. When the world falls apart, some things stay in place. She takes the four tops tape and puts it back in its case. When the world falls apart, some things stay in place. Levi Stubbs tears. So that is even more direct of this whole idea, the act of like listening to the music and putting it away after having listened to it, all that. So I get it. And it's great. I like it. I like it a lot. And it sounds to me like she received a rather shitty hand in life, and her only solace and her only respite in it is this familiar comfort of Motown and old R&B singers who put kind of music to her pain. And the pain conveyed in their music is shared by her vis-a-vis her own life story, and it comforts her. And the arrangement is scant in this tune, as I said earlier, to jump off this. I mean, you basically got a guitar, but and that allows these lyrics to shine as they should. But there is this at points, this like nice. And to me, it sounded like a mounted tambourine because it sounded more hit than and less like this. It sounded like it was stuck in place and someone was striking it. I could totally be throwing shit at the wall there, but there's clearly some tambourine use throughout the song, or like later in the song. And then even later in the song, there are these like auxiliary percussions and hand drums and what I'm going to assume is a trumpet that kind of like leads into that is part of the fade out. And I don't know. Is it a trumpet? Can you confirm with me if it is?
There's two different instruments.
Okay.
If you notice, it goes with one phrase and then the other, and they're two different. According to the notes from the album I read, the first little bit, which is slightly, I think, softer but higher, is a flugelhorn.
Oh.
And then the second bit is a trumpet.
Okay. Which I thought was an interesting choice of instrument, and pardon my ignorance, I'm sure this probably comes from an inherited part of y'all's culture, but a lot of times when there is something sad that occurs or an event that commemorates a sad event, like a funeral, obviously is the first thing you come to mind when you think about this. Now, I don't know if that, maybe it's, maybe he's just going for that same sort of motif and not as nail on the head as it's a funeral, but there's like the idea of like playing taps or something like that on the trumpet.
Yeah.
Yes. So and because that's so mournful and evokes sorrow, and this is a sad song, I thought that was really artistic, smart artistic choice to make for the way to end the sort of fade out aspect of it all too, kind of again go hand in glove and are like really great music
choices when it comes to the composition of this thing. So yeah, I thought that was all interesting. I picked up on, I think, a lot of what O'Bragg was trying to throw down. But you can fill in the gaps for me, and by all means, tell me about these three gentlemen who I don't know enough about that you've promised me.
Okay, great. So as Adi mentioned, we sort of covered a lot about Mr. Bragg in that previous episode. I'll probably put a link into that episode on Into the Music. So there's all the stuff about, you know, his early time, his time in Oundle, the army, busking a certain mushroom beer army with Mr. Peel. They're all in there, so you can go and check that out. Just before getting to this, just so you... These first three albums, I think, are seminal. There's lots of other great stuff, and the stuff he did with Wilco as well is just brilliant. But these first three albums, this is the third one, are amazing. But they are of that very simple, almost Woody Guthrie, you know, man and a guitar sort of thing. So
yeah, yeah.
95% of the stuff, definitely, yeah, all of the first album is him and a guitar, nothing else. Second album, there's a couple of touches you heard on Liver Sings with that lovely organ, bits and pieces, not much. And there's a little bit more in this album, but again, a lot of the time it's him and a guitar and it's storytelling. So this was the first single off this album, Talking with the Taxman About Poetry. It was, for the most part, a massive leap forward again for Billy Bragg musically. And there's lots more musicians and instruments on this album than ever before. And the album's actually got the subtitle on it. It says The Difficult Third Album, as a bit of a joke, because I think you just write it asleep. The title, I think we mentioned before, is from a poem by Vladimir Mayakovsky. And the whole poem is actually reproduced on the inner sleeve, which is interesting. The album features the sadly missed Kirsty MacColl on Greetings to the New Brunette and The Passion. And on the same two songs, a certain Mr. Johnny Marr played guitar. Yeah, and there was lots of other contributors. So Dave Woodhead played trumpet and flugelhorn on this track.
Okay.
And this single peaked at number 29 in the UK charts. Just a quick thing about this album. Reviewing it in Rolling Stone, David Handelman, never heard of him, called this album a winning mesh by turns as political as The Clash, as clever as Elvis Costello, as melodic as Ray Davis, and as rocking as Chuck Berry. It is included in the book 101 albums that you must hear before you die. I've got it here, and I always like to do this, so I found it, and then you see what else is around the same pages. Talk The Color of Spring is listed right next to it, and then Megadeth, and then the next page is Slippery When Wet, Bon Jovi. So you can't have it all. But on the previous page, you've got the Infected that we've talked about and listened to, and of course, License to Ill, the Beastie Boys' worst album. But anyway, which I never liked at all, and I'm a big Beastie Boys fan. But anyway, in NME in 2014, they ranked it as 207 in the list of 500 greatest songs of all time. So pretty good. I'll go through the lyrics. Now, the genius about this song really is the quality of the lyric writing. It's a mastery, almost. It's almost this short story writing, you know, that's worthy of Papa Hemingway. It really is. And the way he conjures up scenes with the economy of words is masterful. So yeah, I'll go through it. So the first two lines, I mean, with the money from our accident, she bought herself a mobile home. So you picture it straight away, but you think, what accident? You know, it's just really interesting. So at least you can get some enjoyment out of being alone, which again sets that scenario.
She's on a toss. Yeah, yeah. And I love how he starts off, like you said, with the accident thing, as just like, I'm about to tell you like awful, like specific stuff that kind of, or at least allude to very specific stuff that happened to her. But just to let you know, that's not all of her bad luck. You know, she's just coming off some horrible accident. So yeah, it's like, what a tragic figure.
And you don't know if accident is a euphemism.
Yeah.
You know, whether it's something that's, anyway, so really great. And no one can say that she was left up on the shelf. It's you and me against the world, kid, she mumbled to herself. There's that ding, ding. Well, the world falls apart, some things stay in place. Levi Stubbs' tears run down his face. She ran away from home in her mother's best coat. She was married before she was even entitled to vote. And that's one of the most Billy Bragg lines you'll ever find. A mixture of social comment and politics,
yeah,
wrapped up into a sort of truth. Brilliant. And like, even her mother's best coat is a real image there. Her husband was one of those blokes, the sort who only laughs at his own jokes, the sort a war takes away, but when there wasn't a war, he left anyway. When the war falls apart, some things stay in place. Levi Stubbs' tears run down his face. Norman Whitfield and Barrett Strong are here to make right everything that's wrong. Holland and Lamont Dozier too are here to make it all okay with you. And normally, as you quite rightly say, it's Holland Dozier Holland, but it scams better, so that's why he's done that. And then the really sort of kicker. One dark night, he came home from the sea and put a hole in her body where no hole should be. It hurt her more to see him walking out the door. And though they stitched her back together, they left her heart in pieces on the floor. So I do think it is a physical attack.
Mm-hmm.
And then it finishes, when the world falls apart, some things stay in place. She takes off the full tops tape and puts it back in its case. When the world falls apart, some things stay in place. Levi Stubbs' tears. Yeah, it's really powerful. And actually, I've been listening to this. I was just trying to work out, you know, the best part of 35, maybe nearly 40 years. And it still moves me when I hear it. I think it's just brilliant. And he has got an uncultured voice, which, you know, in some ways, I remember us crowding around a crappy, you know, one of those cassette players that's flat and had big buttons on the end, and you like, mm-hmm. And it ejected it, and you put the cassette in, slammed it down, and it's got one speaker. And there was a bunch of us in 1983, his first album just come out, and it's not a great quality recording. And we're playing it, and he's not got, you know, the most polished of voices, and it sounded rough as hell. And you only had like, you didn't have graphic equalizers, you had tone. So it was either tinny or muffled, you know, when you're trying to turn it up. But it just adds to an element of realism to it, that it sounds like it's coming from his heart, or it's true and it's real, you know, which is, it's a payoff, and, you know, I love it. So just a little bit about some of the people mentioned in this, because I think it's fun and interesting. So Levi Stubbs was born Levi Stubbles. I know the Four Tops, but I've never really watched much footage of them perform, so I don't know if he used to cry when he sang or whatever, if it's just this, you know. But yeah, I love Four Tops, but I don't know a huge amount about the minutiae of them. So he was the lead vocalist of the Four Tops, and they had a shed load of Motown hits during the 60s and 70s. He has been noted for his powerful, emotional, dramatic style of singing. And his cousin was Jackie Wilson. I didn't know that. That's quite amazing. Despite being the most prominent member of the group, this is really interesting, Stubbs refused to have separate billing, in contrast to other Motown acts like Smokey Robinson and the Miracles or Dinah Ross and the Supremes. He also turned down several offers for a solo career out of loyalty to his bandmates. He kept performing the Four Tops until the year 2000, when he suffered a stroke. And of course, he did some voice work in film and television. Most notably is the voice of Audrey 2, the alien plant, in the 1986 musical horror comedy film, Little Shop of Horrors. Feed me.
Yeah, Seymour.
Feed me now. So Norman Whitfield, as you quite rightly say, is an American songwriter and producer who worked with Berry Gordon's Motown labels in the 60s. Amazing. I've got a list here. Yeah. So he's credited as one of the greatest songs of Motown
ever written.
So, during his 25-year career, Whitfield co-wrote and produced many hits, including Ain't Too Proud to Beg, I Know I'm Losing You, I Heard It Through the Grapevine, Cloud Nine, Can't Get Next to You, War, Border Confusion, Just My Imagination, Smiling Faces, Papa Was a Rolling Stone.
Yeah.
He then signed his own label. They had some, you know, shenanigans there. And from his own label, he wrote Car Wash for Rolls-Royce. Mm-hmm. I mean, fuck it now. So he wrote or co-wrote 61 hits in the UK charts and 92 hits in the US charts, which is just phenomenal. His partner, Barrett Strong, was known. I never knew this either. This is amazing. He recorded the first version of Money, That's What I Want, which was written by Berry Gordon. So, you know, and then obviously the Beatles went ahead and did it, made it really famous. But he was the first one, and that was the first ever hit for Motown label. And he died, sadly, in January this year, but obviously shitloads. Now, Holland and Dozier, HDH, was they're brothers, Brian and Eddie Holland and Love Dozier. So the trio wrote, arranged and produced loads of hits that defined the Motown from 62 to 67. They were the composers for each song, and Dozier and Brian Holland and Eddie Holland wrote the lyrics and then arranged the vocals. The most celebrated productions were the singles for the Four Tops and Supremes, including 10 of the Supremes' 12 number one singles, including Baby Love, Stop in the Name of Love, You Keep Me Hanging On. They wrote and produced 25 number one hit singles in total, such as Heatwave for Marvin and the Vandellas and How Sweet It Is to Be Loved by You by Marvin Gaye. Oh, wow. From 1969 to 1972, due to a legal dispute with Motown, they did not write material under their own names, but instead used a collective pseudonym, Edith Wayne. So there you go. That's a little bit of info about the protagonist in the song. I absolutely, as you can tell, I adore this song, and I'm glad you liked it as well. And it's just a masterful storytelling, and it creates this atmosphere. And I think by this point, by 86, when it came out, I'm very used to just Billy Bragg with just his guitar. Uh-huh. So actually hearing a flugelhorn and everything, it's just, it's wild, it's crazy. You know, it's instrumental gone mad for me, where it's very, very bare and naked for everyone else. I understand that.
I just love that if he was going to choose to add additional instruments, it was a very thoughtful, intentional decision to do that, right?
And
it was
right on the money what he's added, you know.
Yeah.
If it had been a xylophone, it just wouldn't have worked.
Right, exactly. Or your beloved bagpipes there at the end.
Yes, that was the next one going to come out of my lips. Levi Stubbs tears. It wouldn't have worked.
It's a Scottish funeral.
Yeah. So thanks, Mike and Mark, for recommending this one. It is about in tune. And,
yeah, I'm glad I got really to listen to it. Really appreciate it.
Brilliant. I'll wrap things up and say thanks everybody out there for watching this. Hope you enjoyed it. You know what to do if you did, and that is hit the like button. Drop some comments about this song, about other Billy Bragg songs. Also, I'm super familiar about the first five albums and other bits and pieces and this stuff, you know, Mermaid Avenue with Wilco. But yeah, let us know what you think. I'd love particularly to hear your views on the first three albums, you guys out there, and songs from there. Anything you want to add or suggest, please do. We love interacting with you and seeing your wonderful comments. If you haven't subscribed, you're really missing out on life. Think about it. And then do it. And that being said, we'll see all of you next time. But before we do, I have to leave you with some lyrics from The Bard of Barking. And I realized as I was typing these out so I could read them, because I know them off by heart, but as soon as you put a camera up, you forget everything in your head. I've been listening to this song for the best part of 40 goddamn years. So there you go. So some wise words from Mr. Bragg. The busy girl buys beauty. The pretty girl buys style. And the simple girl buys what she's told to buy and sees her world through the brightly lit eyes of the glossy romance of fashion, where she can learn top tips for the gas cook, successful secrets of the sexual kind, the daily drill for beautiful hair, and the truth about pain. We see all of you next time on the Audiophiles.
See you guys.